Don't we need a bit of rain? A sweltering heatwave has delivered scorching temperatures right across the country, and Queensland is set to feel it in the coming days, while New South Wales has been given a preview of what could be a dangerous fire season as we head into summer. We have team coverage for you this morning at home. First to Reece D'Alessandro at Ipswich, south of Brisbane. Reece, it is going to be extremely hot where you are all week. What is the warning from authorities?
Yeah, that's right, Carl. It'll be in the 30s and nearing 40 degrees here, 41 degrees here actually in Ipswich today. The warning from authorities, take care over the next 3 days in particular. That is going to be the worst period of this heatwave. The warning from health authorities to stay hydrated and to stay cool. But we'll see November heat records tumbling today in places like Cunnamulla. There'll be a 45 degree maximum today at Dalby and the Darling Downs. We'll see 41 degrees, and at Gundawindi on the border, 45 degrees there. The November record, 42 degrees at Gundawindi. But we should see that one surpassed today. Not only will it be 45 at Gundawindi today, we'll see 44 degrees there tomorrow and 46 degrees there on Wednesday. That will make for the hottest three consecutive days on record. Even in Brisbane, temperatures will be nearing 40 degrees over the next 3 days. These worsening conditions have our fire crews on high alert, Carl. They're particularly worried about the Fraser Island bushfire at this point. It has been raging for 6 weeks now. Take a listen.
That fire's burnt out almost 40% of the island, the northern part of the island, and the fire's currently sitting about 2.3 kilometres north of the Kingfisher Bay Resort.
So the travel advice to Fraser Island remains that travel is restricted to Fraser Island this morning, Carl, but the fire, it is at advice level as we go to air.
Good on you, Reece. Thank you.
In New South Wales, there is a warning about complacency after fires in Sydney's west, northwest and the Blue Mountains. Today's Gabrielle Boyle is at RFS headquarters in Sydney. And Gabby, the Commissioner has just spoken. Is he concerned about this fire activity?
He certainly is concerned, Ali. It's little wonder, really, when you consider we've had 200 fires in New South Wales since Friday alone. Not a great start to the season, can be said. We've currently, this morning, got 54 fires burning, and three of them are listed as not contained. We caught up with the fire commissioner just a short time ago on the show. Here's a little of what he had to say.
We've still got 54 fires. Three of those are not contained, and obviously fire crews will be working hard to get those under control.
The main areas of concern for the RFS over the next few months, Ali, are western parts of New South Wales. That's where we've seen a lot of rainfall after a drought period, very high grass growth, and farmers are having bumper crops as well. So we know that that's great news for the farmers, but it can also be a lethal combination for fires with hot and dry conditions forecast over the next few months. As of today, things are set to cool down a little bit, so that is good news and a bit of a reprieve for those firefighters before things pick up again tomorrow.
Okay, thanks for that, Gabby.
Tens of thousands of Melburnians are heading back to the office today, but facing strict rules to wear face masks at their desks. Today, Melbourne reporter Christina Hearn is in the CBD this morning. Chris, good morning to you. Victoria is officially COVID-free. So why the mask rule?
Well, Alex, it is still compulsory in Melbourne to wear a mask when you can't socially distance or if you are indoors. So that means office workers that are returning today do have to wear them in their workplace. Non-essential workers are back in the office for the first time in 8 months today, but there are rules. Only 25% of the workplace is allowed, and of course that mask rule, which has angered the Victorian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. They believe when a worker sits down at the desk, they should be able to take off their mask, similar to what is allowed in the hospitality industry. This is all about getting more people back into the workplace in the city, and of course generating more foot traffic for those traders that have been really struggling over the last couple of months. I have to tell you that it has been pretty quiet here this morning on Collins Street. Not many people in trams at all. In fact, there's only about half a dozen in that tram that's just gone by. But I did manage to find one office worker returning to work a short time ago.
It's really important for me to get with people and be with people and talk and solve problems that way rather than over the wire.
Do you have a problem wearing a mask in the workplace?
No, it's okay. It's pretty good.
it is going to be a test for our public transport network. You, of course, do have to wear a mask when you're using it or even at a tram stop, and we are being told that that is something that is going to be monitored. Alex?
Christine, movement, people behind you.
Yeah, it's amazing. Queensland's tourism industry, meantime, is hoping to make up for lost time when its border wall comes down to Victorians and Sydneysiders within hours. Greg Davin, a tourism operator on the Gold Coast, says despite the COVID blow, the industry will bounce back.
We sort of had the borders closed for around about the 8 months, and for a large part of the tourism business, we were closed for three of those as well with no income. So, you know, it's been a very hard year. We've learned a lot of lessons out of it, and it's a very resilient industry.
The Palaszczuk government has launched a Good to Go campaign to welcome back holidaymakers and support tourism.
While the world mourns the loss of Diego Maradona, his doctor is being investigated for his actions during the final days of the football legend's life. The dramatic new development has seen the home and office of his personal doctor raided, who is being investigated for involuntary manslaughter 4 days after the icon suffered a fatal heart attack.
Incredible. Here's a story you're not going to see everywhere, but I kind of like it. A mysterious metal monolith discovered last week in the Utah desert has now disappeared. Utah's Bureau of Land Management says the 3.6 metre high object has been removed by an unknown party. These pictures showing just a pile of rocks and a small piece of metal left behind. Wildlife officials originally spotted the unusual structure while counting sheep during a flyover of the remote US state just days ago.
I mean, if that's not aliens, what is?
What is it? Wildlife officials counting sheep.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
From a plane.
From a plane.
Mm-hmm. Not easy. None of that's
have
easy.
Have you tried?
Okay. We've got the entire newsroom working on that story. Trying to find some answers, so we'll come back with those.
Thank you, buddy.
Okay, no worries. Let's go to sport right now. And the motorsport world is reeling this morning after a truly shocking crash in the Formula One Bahrain Grand Prix. The car of Haas driver Romain Grosjean was torn in half upon impact before being engulfed in flames. Look at that. Wow. Yet somehow he walked away from the wreckage with only minor injuries. And in breaking news, Romain has just posted an update on social media. Have a look at this.
Just wanted to say I am okay, well, sort of okay, thanks to all the medical staff at the circuit, at the hospital, and hopefully I can write you quite soon some messages and tell you where it's going.
Isn't that incredible?
Incredible.
It's an incredible story. And to help talk us through it, we're now joined by Aussie former F1 driver Tim Schenken. Good morning to you, Tim.
Good morning, Alex.
Seeing that for the first time, how did you react?
Well, I was watching the race live last night, and it was a shock, to be honest. It's very seldom you see a Formula One car, any race car nowadays, catch fire in an accident, but that was obviously very violent. And then we had to wait some 5 minutes or so before we saw the replays, before I saw the replays, and Romain thankfully was out of the car.
Yeah, he was in there for about 10 seconds, we're told, so it would have felt like a lot longer. But the reaction from the drivers in pit lane, it was pretty emotional. We saw Lewis Hamilton head bowed down, just completely silent. How would they have felt witnessing something like that, do you think?
Well, I imagine many of them have never seen an accident like that. I mean, in my days, that would have been a fatality or someone certainly very seriously hurt. But they were shocked, no question about it at all. And to have an accident with fire as well, is very, very unusual.
Yeah, well, you would have remembered Niki Lauda's accident too. I mean, that would have brought back memories of that, I'd imagine.
Well, I saw lots of, there were lots of accidents in my time, but, you know, motor racing is, you know, considering the speeds, is remarkably safe. We think it's safe, and every now and then you have an accident like this come along to give us a wake-up call.
Well, the safety measures now are second to none, so we are thankful for that, and we are thankful that that young man is okay.